delighted to welcome our students, staff, and friends of Middlesex University. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to hear the address from the Reverend Jesse Jackson. And on behalf of Middlesex University, may I say, Reverend Jackson, that you are most welcome. I'm delighted that you are here to address the students, staff, and friends of Middlesex University. Let me say something about my university. Middlesex University, I believe, is a working example of what you, Reverend Jackson, have been striving for throughout most of your life. There can be few, if any, universities that are as diverse in the international and ethnic backgrounds of its staff and students as here at Middlesex University. There are over 150 nationalities among our students studying together in an inclusive and harmonious atmosphere. If you would beg my indulgence, Reverend Jackson, let me illustrate this to you. If you care to look behind you, put your hand up for Reverend Jackson if you're from Africa. Put your hand up for Reverend Jackson if you're from North or South America. Put your hand up for Reverend Jackson if you're from the Middle East and Asia. And put your hand up for Reverend Jackson if you're from Europe. And is there anyone here from London? Put your hand up for Reverend Jackson. Thank you. Now, we're not smug and self-satisfied about our diversity. We've worked hard to be welcoming to people from all backgrounds, and we know we have to keep on working at it. And we also recognize that there is much to be done in all countries to overcome the ignorance that breeds discrimination and exclusion. Middlesex University is committed to using its educational mission to support this cause. Now, Reverend Jackson needs no introduction, but I am nonetheless going to ask my colleague, Professor Kurt Barling, to remind us of some of his achievements. But before I do, I'd like to thank Professor Barling for personally persuading Reverend Jackson to visit Middlesex University on this most important anniversary of the civil rights movement. Professor Barling.
Middlesex University, London. I'm feeling this is a special day. I'm extraordinarily proud to introduce the Reverend Jackson to our great university. You know, back in September, I was at the House of Commons at a dinner for a select few, of which I was had the honor to be invited. Reverend Jackson was the guest of honor. It was organized by a Middlesex University alumni, Simon Woolley. Simon, stand, please. Through Operation Black Vote, Simon has led the national debate on engaging all voters in the political process, irrespective of their ethnicity. He's done it for 2 decades. He is just one Middlesex leader out there working in our communities. Back at that dinner, Reverend Jackson and his staff happened to mention they would be returning to speak at Cambridge University and Oxford University on the need for a vision for greater diversity in that part of the university academy. Of course, never one to pass up an opportunity. I suggested he come and inspire our university that has been broadening access and diversity and has put it centerfold in its agenda for the best part of 20 years. If you want to see diversity now, I said, come and see us. University is, of course, about scholarship. It's about training. It's about degrees. But it's also about values and leadership in our communities. We, across the faculties, as staff, must provide the inspiration to create leaders in health and education, leaders in business and management, leaders in law, leaders in art and design, leaders in science and technology, and yes, leaders in the performing arts and my own department, media. What better guest then to have amongst us tonight than a man who sought to lead one of the great nations of the world, inspired by a philosophy of equality and justice. And I'm proud to say our students made that marvelous film to reflect those ambitions. Now, Reverend Jackson may not have secured the Democratic nomination from the presidency in 1984 or 1988, although he ran his opponents pretty close. But pause a while and reflect. Make no mistake. As Simon Woolley would say, hear me now. There would be no President Barack Obama without Reverend Jesse Jackson. Here's a picture. You saw it at the end of that student movie. It's a fantastic picture of the Reverend Jackson. He presented it to me when he was last here. On it he wrote, "Keep hope alive." What struck me about this picture, it's in my study and I look at it every time I go in there, is this. He and Dr. King were in that picture, 26 and 39, I believe, full of hope. They were young people. It was just months before Dr. King was slain by the assassin's bullet. They were young and created a movement that demanded the world change, and change it did. What is the moral? The moral is, young people here, you can be the change. Young people change the world. They need inspiration, that's why they come to university. Dr. King and Reverend Jackson had vision. They had clarity of thought, determination and resilience, all qualities that made them part of the change. That's why the film the students made is called Be the Change. These are qualities that students leaving Middlesex will need. If we fire their imaginations, they too will be the change. We will inspire them to lead in whatever walk of life they choose. They will be somebody. What makes an activist great? Certainly, when your natural opponents respect your views and seek to emulate many of your values, you must have something of greatness about you. That House of Commons dinner again in September. It was hosted by none other than the Commons Speaker, John Bercow. Not a natural ally, you might think, of Jesse Jackson, and certainly by political philosophy and method there are profound differences. But remember this, when his young children were at the pre-dinner reception, John Bercow wanted a family picture taken with Reverend Jackson. John Bercow told his children this, "In your lifetimes, children, come here, I want this picture taken now. You might not encounter greatness that often. Remember, they live in the House of Commons. Greatness is supposed to be all around them." That night, he told them, "You are in the presence of greatness. This is the picture that was taken." That picture speaks volumes for how far this freedom fighter has traveled since 1963. From Dr. Martin Luther King's dream speech to presidential campaigner and now a hero of a Conservative Speaker of the Mother of All Parliaments, please give a warm Middlesex welcome to Reverend Jesse Jackson.
Good afternoon. Let me express my sincere thanks for the opportunity to share with you this evening and the joy and electricity I feel in this room. To my friend and brother, who is such an outstanding scholar, activist, journalist, do not take him for granted. He means so much to all of us. Kurt, stand again, please. It's a joy to be with you on this occasion. Today I look forward to sharing some observations with you. I was invited to come to Cambridge on Monday and Oxford on Tuesday and up to Middlesex on Wednesday. This is moving one up for me. Let's give it up. When Dr. King was killed in 1968, our hearts bled, our heads hung down. We were traumatized, didn't know where to go, hardly what to do, except we knew that we would not allow one bullet to kill a whole movement. So we marched with heavy hearts and tear-stained eyes. One bullet would not have the power to kill a movement. And then a few months later, 2 months later, June 5th, Robert Kennedy was killed. Now, the King is preparing for the last campaign was a poor people's campaign, demanded there be a job, an income, a health care for everybody. There should be a floor beneath which no one would fall. He felt we had made a tragic mistake, shifting resources from the war on poverty to the war on Vietnam. And in that struggle, he was slain. I was asked if we put together a kind of makeshift city of tents, a camp to symbolize the poor people's campaign, those who work but still were malnourished, those who work but could not send their children to school. And so I was the mayor. We convened every morning to give some guidance to that day's activities. And on that morning, with Dr. King dead and Robert Kennedy dead and despair abounding, they were looking up in my face as if to say, give me something. It was raining. Most men had left the camp. A couple had died from hepatitis. And I had no money to give them, no bus fare for them to get back home. I had no thing to give them. I remember the book I'd read some years ago, before then, by Dr. Howard Thurman called Jesus and the Disinherited, in which he argues that when your back is against the wall, you stand naked against the wall, reduced to your irreducible essence. There's nothing left but your being. There's power in your being. You matter just because you are. And I said to them, say, I am somebody. That I affirm myself. What I do not have on, what I wish I had, I still am. So I matter. I am somebody. It was a statement of self-affirmation, and across the years, we've used that challenging statement. I want you at Middlesex today to join that rhythm, to be a part of that. To my right, say, I am. I am. Like you mean it, I am. I am. Come alive, I am. I am. Somebody. Somebody. I am. I am. Come on now, I am. Somebody. Show them how I am. Somebody. I am. Everybody get up, everybody get up, everybody get up. Say, I am. Somebody. Somebody. I am. Somebody. Somebody. My mind is a pearl. I can learn anything. in the world if my mind can conceive it and my heart can believe it. I know I can achieve it. It is not my aptitude, but my attitude will determine my altitude, how high I will rise. I'll rise higher, aim high, rise higher. Aim high, rise higher. Red and yellow, brown, black, and white. We are all precious in God's sight. Everybody matters. Everybody is somebody. The only justification for looking down on someone is to stop and pick them up and raise them higher and higher and higher. I am God's child. I am God's child. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Middlesex, number one. Let me hear you scream. Many of you get snippets of Dr. King's speech, the great march on Washington in 1963. There is a context to that speech. After 246 years in slavery, raping Africa of its people and its resources, 246 years, for the most valuable commodity was not land, nor banks, nor insurance, but the African slave trade. And America had become addicted to that labor without wages, that human wealth exploitation. To maintain that system, they're willing to ally with Britain and France and build another nation and split America into North and South. There was a civil war in which 800,000 Americans were killed, more than any other war before or since. 800,000 people killed in that war. And when the war was over, the Union had prevailed. We saved the Union and we abolished slavery. We celebrate Thanksgiving once a year in America on the last Thursday in the month of November. And while for many years it was used as a kind of gathering of the harvest in the fall of the year, after the Gettysburg War, with the blood stain in the ground and the stench flying in the breeze, Lincoln declared Thanksgiving to be a national holiday, a thanks to God for saving the Union and for ending slavery, 246 years of slavery. Blacks who had been enslaved were empowered January 1st, 1863 by Abraham Lincoln to pick up arms to join the Union Army to win that war. So we were not just given some freedom, we fought for that freedom and fought for that dignity. We were promised upon the winning of that war that we will have full citizenship. For 12 years, there was something called Reconstruction. For the first time, we could own land. For the first time, we could go to school. It had been illegal to learn to read or write. We could gather in numbers greater than three. We could own land. We could build schools. We could build churches. We could build business. We'd begun to grow in something called Reconstruction for 12 years, acknowledging that there had been 246 years of denial. The same forces that we fought against and fought with allied and cut a deal in 1877, the Tilden-Hayes Compromise, to pull the troops from the South where we mostly lived at the time. When that happened, they unleashed the Night Riders and the Klan, the terrorists, drove us back into the hills, back into the countryside, unleashed terror, began to have elections where we could not vote. By 1896, it stacked the courts And the courts voted apartheid. 1896, the courts voted apartheid in the Plessy versus Ferguson case. For another 58 years, we struggled to move from separate but equal, which in fact was unequal, vote to fight against apartheid. And lawyers from Howard University, not Harvard, but Howard University, won the lawsuit to end apartheid. Next year, Rosa Parks sat down from the bus, refused to go to the back. But that was not because she had tired feet, as the caricature goes. She was a freedom fighter. She was an organizer, worked with Attorney Fred Gray, and they tested the 54 decision by her refusing to go to the back of the bus, and for that she was arrested. Arrested because above the driver's head, rear the sign, colored seat from the rear, whites from the front, and those who violate would be punished by law. It was state law that she violated intentionally in the act of civil disobedience. 57, the next year, students at Little Rock Central High tested the case again. There was such reaction, such bitterness, hatred, and terrorism, until the National Guard had to be empowered to escort students to school in 1957. 1964, students in Greensboro, North Carolina, sat down to get hamburgers, they got handcuffs. Unleashed a student dynamic across the South and across the nation, demanding freedom now. In 1963, it was a year that we were bringing the matter to a head. That's the year that Dr. King and Mandela were both arrested, Dr. King in America, Mandela in South Africa, during the height of the treason trial. That year, Dr. King was arrested and put in Birmingham jail. We wrote the letter from Birmingham jail in 63. I was arrested for inciting a riot in 63, which was nothing more than civil disobedience. Meg Evers was killed June 12th, 1963. The March on Washington, 1963, August 28th. The speech, arguably, Kurt, was not about the dream. It was about the broken promise. The media somehow captured the dream, the alliterative, poetic climax. So we gather here today, this large demonstration, in the shadows of Lincoln's monument, his majestic shadows. You promised January 1st, 1863, that we'd be free. Looking straight ahead to the Congress, he said, in the 13th Amendment, you promised. Yet here we stand today. Promissory note, bounce check marked insufficient funds. The day he gave that speech, August 20th of 63, Simon, from Texas to Florida, up to Maryland, we couldn't use a single public toilet. Dogs could take pictures on the lawn of state capitals, but African Americans could not. My father, veteran of World War II, and black soldiers had to sit behind Nazi prisoners of war on American military bases. They were Nazis, but at least they were white. They were therefore ideological race supremacist allies. Our money was counterfeit. We could not buy ice cream at Howard Johnson's unless we go to the back door. Did not have the right to vote. Couldn't rent a room at Holiday Inn. In abject rejection, legal, vulnerable, unprotected. I dream of a day. You broke the promise. Promissory note, bounce check, marked insufficient funds. I refuse to believe a nation so great as ours can't honor the promise. We can win world wars and build great universities, great infrastructure, dam waters and make electricity. I refuse to believe a nation so great as ours cannot honor its promise. I dream of a day you'll honor the broken promise. My kids can go to the theme park and not be violated. You know the dream part, but there's a context. I dream of a day when you will honor the broken promise. That the king was only famous, he was great. All of us could not be famous because all of us could not be well known. All can be great, each can be great because each can serve. As I look back across these 50 years since 63, what are your obstacles and challenges today? One, too much accepted racism. Too much poverty. Too much violence, expensive, unnecessary wars. Too much racism. The idea that one group is superior to another by virtue of birth. One group has normal blood, one has royal blood. If you believe that, have a car wreck and see which blood bank you go to today. Racism is unscientific. But it was taught as a pseudoscience in the schools. Indeed, in Harvard and Princeton and Oxford and Cambridge. Taught. It's politically divisive. It's emotionally disturbing. Exploitative, divisive. Ungodly. It's a sin. It's ungodly. Can we build the whole social order on the premise of race and gender supremacy? So men and women had to fight to overcome the barriers created by the ignorance and meanness and hostility and hurt of racism. He was not only historical as a kind of first, he was transformative. Because he worked to change the law. We live in our faith, whatever our faith may be, we live under the law. Montgomery bus boycott prevailed in 1955, but in 56, the law was affirmed that we were on the right side of history and the law. 1964, we won the public accommodation. You go to any hotel, motel, park, or library, not being stopped by race. We ended apartheid legally, as a matter of fact, ratified by the Congress in 64. In 1965, the right to vote. Our democracy is not 200 plus years old, as it's commonly written down. Our democracy is 48 years old. We're just 48-year-old democracy. Slavery and democracy cannot coexist. That was not democracy, slaveocracy. 100 years of legal Jim Crow where only white men could vote. It's not democracy. Women couldn't vote. Blacks couldn't vote. Latinos could not vote. That was not democracy. Jim Crowocracy. 1965, based upon the blood of the humble and the honest, and the pain and the hurt, marched, faced the dogs and the kicking horses and the bull whips. Out of that innocent blood came the power to transform the nation. Old blacks could not vote in the South. It was commonly forgotten white women could not serve on juries. No white woman on the Supreme Court in 1965. 18-year-olds who served in Vietnam could not vote. Students could not vote on campuses. And to be here today, fighting rising tuition on the one hand, and looking for a job on the other. Fighting rising tuition on the one hand, and not the promise of a job, and not be registered, is a living, walking, talking contradiction. Your vote will determine the priorities of the nation, will determine the winner of the nation. 18-year-olds got the right to vote. We've got the right to vote on campus. We've got the right to vote bilingually. in 1975. And then proportionally, delegate representation in 1988. When I first ran in 1984 for the presidency to open up the process, I noticed we had far more popular votes than delegates. I didn't understand that there was a system where it's called winner take all. So if I get 49, someone else gets 50.1, they take all. That was bad math, and so we challenged that arrangement. It was another scheme to, in fact, control the process and lock people out. In 88, we challenged it, and we were able to get, if I get 49% of the vote, I get that percentage of delegates. You get 50.1, you get 50.1 with delegates. So we've got something called proportionality. But when it became real was in 2008 when President Barack Obama ran. And when the race got real tight and looked like he really might win for real, Hillary Clinton won California barely. She won Texas barely. She won Ohio barely. She won Pennsylvania. Without the new rules, she would have been the winner. But the 88 rule change gave him proportional share of his votes. He won because we never stopped fighting. From 6 to 8 to 8, we would not allow one or two bullets to kill a movement. We used what we had and didn't cry about what we didn't have. Against the odds, you can make it. If you're behind, run faster. 13th Amendment was won by 2 votes. Margins matter. John Kennedy, 1960, won by 113,000 votes. Less than 1 vote per precinct. 8,000 in the ghetto of Chicago. Margins matter. Gore won but lost to Bush because they stole the election by 612 votes. Margins matter. So you sit here demanding more jobs, more education, less tuition. Your vote matters. You matter. But if you are a giant with a grasshopper complex, you won't use your power. Against the odds, you can make it. Your suffering becomes a trigger to power. Suffering breeds faith. Faith breeds suffering, and suffering breeds character. And in the end, faith will prevail. If you're behind, run faster. Get up early in the morning. Be more determined. Value your person because you matter. It's amazing how God gets in this thing every now and then. There was a gentleman, the first African-American Secret Service agent named Mr. A. Bolden. Great resistance to his being in Secret Service by the other agents, by the local law enforcement agencies. President Kennedy came to Chicago. Ordinarily, he would be upstairs where the president was because he was a Secret Service agent. They put him down to guard the toilet. So the police would be guarding the toilet and put him upstairs where the Secret Service man should be. A kind of racial punishment. As the case ends, President Kennedy had to use the toilet. He came downstairs and met him and asked about him. He said, I'm a Secret Service agent. He said, would you like to be the Jackie Robinson of the Secret Service agents and be the first? He said, I will be with your appointment. When God is in this thing, margins become mighty. President Kennedy, watching his parade of celebration once he had won, looked up and saw no blacks in the color guard. Said there should be blacks in the color guard. As it were, one of our classmates, James Felder, became one of the 3. 2 of them retired. When Kennedy was killed, he had become the senior color guard officer. James Felder marched Meg Evers to the grave in June. He was in charge of the whole array. He watched the autopsy of President Kennedy and climbed the plane, landed in the gravesite. Just by the margin, he didn't come from Harvard or from Yale or Princeton. He came from Clark College. He came from Middlesex, not Oxford, not Cambridge. He came from Middlesex. Harvard boasts of having the great lawyers and the great law school, Yale the great law school, but the lawsuit, the end of apartheid, the one that we brag about. Now, we're not a segregated nation. We're civil. That lawsuit came from Howard, not Harvard. It came from Middlesex. You can make it. Dr. King went to a segregated school in Georgia. Oh, before he was dreaming, at age 14, he was debating blacks in the Constitution, at age 14. In the Morehouse at age 15. Finished Morehouse at 19. In the seminary at 22. Got his PhD at 26. He used what he had. Born ordinary. Under conditions subordinary, and rose to extraordinary because his will to make a difference. It's not enough to survive. We've learned to survive. We now have a harder lesson than surviving. We've learned to survive. Now we must learn to live together. Say, we have learned to survive. Lowercase animals, they survive, but they can't dream. Rabbits and rodents, insects survive, but they can't dream. So we have learned to survive apart. Now, as high animals, just a little less than God, just a little lower than angels, we must now learn to live together as brothers and sisters and not die apart as fools. Your education is the best that Britain has to offer, because you're learning to coexist and to lead, not to rule. In this age, ruling is over. It's about governing with the consent. See, in this day, ruling is over. Governing is in with the consent of the governed. I'll be governed if it's my choice, or not be ruled because I am somebody. Learning to live together. Why must we have a multiracial, multicultural mix such as yours here today? Why is your lessons learning here more profound than Oxford or Cambridge or Harvard or Princeton or Columbia? Because education is vertical. It is learning to write the great essays. It is learning to be literate, to conjugate subject and verb. It is to be able to think and conceptualize essays and master higher math. It is all of that. But life is more than vertical. Life is also breadth and depth. A's in learning and F's in living is a bad mark. Learning to read and write and think and count requires that one have some depth of experience, some knowledge of pain, and then turn pain to power. Say, knowledge requires vertical development, to read, to write, to count, to think, conceptualize. But life also involves character, learning how to live together, learning how to live with people. Nature matters. Environment matters. So I say to my friends there at the great universities who have some construct, they write the best essays and get the highest grades because from elementary school right on, they were taught by graduates from those schools. He says, here's how you get there. They were taught essay writing from high school on. And so by the time for the college, it was just the 13th grade. They were trained to write the essay and get in. Bush went to Yale. Blair went to Oxford. They sat together and both of them took us to an unnecessary war in Iraq. That's how well they thought. People at Oxford and Yale and the great schools justified apartheid in South Africa. They never pulled out of South Africa. They thought it was all right to lock Mandela up 27 years. They could read, write, count, and think, but they couldn't feel. It's important. Say it's important. The people know. It's important that we know. People care that we know. People care that we know. People care that we know. But it's better that people know that we care. Caring matters. While that puts this emphasis to you today on this issue of multicultural education, because the world is multicultural, apparently God is multicultural. God is not just a white man, or brown, or yellow. Apparently, the Spirit of God is not limited by race, gender, religion. The sun shines upon us with rays not limited by color or sex or religion. Why must we learn to live together? Half of the human race is Asian. Half of them are Chinese. And they were not discovered by Nixon. One-eighth of the human race is African, one-fourth Nigerian, whose wealth built Britain. In North America, two-thirds of our neighbors speak Spanish, one-third speak English is a minority language in our hemisphere. Most people in the world today are yellow, brown, black, non-Christian, poor, female, young, and don't speak English. See, most people, most people in the world today are yellow, brown, black, non-Christian, poor, female, young, and don't speak English. And if we spoke English only in church, Jesus did not speak English, it would not be welcome. Can I get a witness here? Dr. King changed the law, but he basically, Kurt, changed our minds. As a man or a woman thinketh, so is he. There is this story of Moses sending Joshua and the group out to spy the land that God had promised them. And they took out the group and they saw the land, they saw the grass, the flowers, the fruits, the babbling brooks. They saw all God had promised them. Here you are from Jamaica and Africa and Europe, all around the world, all that you've been promised. Here you got it. You're in Britain. Paved roads and hot and cold running water, latest technology, the best of education. Here you are in the promised land. Well, we saw what was promised, the majority report said, the majority. But we can't win, even though we saw what was promised to us, because there are giants in the land. You think those tall men are greater than God? You mean God promised but cannot deliver because there are some tall guys in the land? That was the majority report. Joshua came back, one of his reasons for becoming the next leader. He said, yes, there are giants there, but we can overcome. In other words, Joshua was a minority with a majority complex. That's what made Moses great. He was a minority with a majority complex. That's what made Jesus so astounding. He was minority, born a Jew under occupation, under death warrant, poor, in a manger, not a mansion, had to become a refugee and go to Egypt to survive. A minority with a majority complex. I will not bow to Herod's threats, nor will I bow to the corruption of our religious order. I have been known to preach. I see something different here. To preach the gospel, good news to the poor. All of God's children matter. Dr. King was a minority with a majority complex. Can a black become prime minister of Britain? Not if you expect to be drafted. Say, I can, I will, I must. There's nothing I cannot do. Nothing I cannot be or become, because I am somebody. I am God's child. Whatever God promised, God can deliver. Lastly, strong minds break strong chains. That's why I want all of you to join the Rainbow Coalition and join Operation Black Vote. Say, strong minds break strong chains. My vote, my attitude is the margin of victory. My vote, my attitude is the margin of victory. Who knows? But some Middlesex student might have in his or her mind the cure to cancer. Or to AIDS. Or have the passion for drinkable water for everybody. Who knows? But in this place, right here now, might be the key to world peace. It can happen. It has not happened, but it can. A month ago, we prepared to have war with Iran, and the war drums were beating, and they were making more bombs and more planes, and Iran said, well, let's decide to beat our swords and apply shares and spears and the pruning hooks, and let's not study war. It disrupted the war machine, just giving peace a chance. One thing worse than slavery. One thing worse than slavery is to adjust to it. One thing worse than oppression is to adjust to it. One thing worse than that is to rationalize that it's all right. I can make it somehow. So I must never adjust to oppression. I must never rationalize. I must never rationalize it's all right. When God made minds, my mind was the best that God has offered. I have the power to change the world. I have the power to change the world. If it's dark, real dark, one light will challenge all the darkness. Somebody in this room would dare to run for prime minister of Britain. Say, well, if I can't run, white folks won't vote for me. You don't know that. They might be tired of mediocrity. They might be looking for you. Maybe they've heard enough of those who thought they inherited it. Say, effort and excellence means a lot. Effort, excellence And hard work means a lot. Effort, hard work, and excellence means a lot. Inheritance and access means more. I must fight to overcome the odds put upon me by inheritance, access, and laws of perpetuity. If I'm behind, I run faster. If I'm behind, I get up early in the morning. Why does the cage bird sing? It sings to say that I exist. That's why the bird is singing. If the door swings open, I fly out of here. Why does the cage bird sing? Because it has a voice to do so. Even the cage cannot stop your dream. So I dream because I'm alive, because I will to do so. Lastly, at the end of the day, and I put great emphasis on studying diligently and learning to read and write, count and think, why are we so good at soccer? Why does the soccer team, why is it black and white? Why do they look for soccer players to come here from Africa and one or two from Brazil if they can steal them? Why are we so good at soccer, basketball, track, golf, and tennis? To be the best basketball player, to be the best golfer, best tennis player, best football player is hard. It's real hard. Now watch this. If on that football field, American football, if those who are white had to run 8 yards for a first down because they inherited some yards, and those who are black had to run 12 yards because they were born out of wedlock, you could never catch up. See, if on the soccer field, the team with the highest grades had 2 extra points, we wouldn't win in the game. Said, but whenever the playing field is even, and the rules are public, and the goals are clear, and the referee is fair, I can make it. Put your hands together. So I can make it. So I can make it. You know, there is this character theme best expressed, I suppose, for me, when a man was walking down the street one day, Kurt, attending to his business. Some thieves jumped from behind a blind corner with people that had been frequently robbed, beat and robbed him and left him to die. I suppose since people had been frequently robbed there, maybe they should have cleaned away the corner and done some infrastructure work, but they didn't do that. People kept getting beat at that corner. While lying there bleeding to death, he looked up and finally saw a reverend, a rabbi, a man of God of his own religion. He assumed that the man would come give him rescue, but the man walked to the other side of the street, Bible in one hand, prayer book in the other, and kept walking. Jesus said, "Who is your neighbor?" Another man, the Levite of his own race, his own soul brother, saw him laying there and he went to the other side and kept walking. "Who is my neighbor?" Another man from another country, another race, another religion, an immigrant without a green card who worshiped God differently, the Samaritan, stopped and picked him up. Beyond color and culture's character. Character is about caring and sharing, not just having and consuming. It's about the character thing. Jesus said in calling the lost sheep in that parable, "Come hither." And 99 got there real fast. He said, "Where's my lost sheep?" But Jesus, we're here. We got here first. I know that, and congratulations. But enough of you here to take care of each other. What about my lost sheep? Well, we heard you, we came running. Maybe my lost sheep couldn't hear. Maybe it has a hearing defect, which is not so obvious to the eye. Maybe it got kicked by a bigger sheep. Maybe it has a limp leg. It may have stepped on a nail. All I really know is that now the sun is going down and it's getting cool, and snakes might be crawling to bite my sheep. My divinity rests on how I treat the lost one. How I treat the lost sheep. That's the character factor. Bring it a little close to home and I let you go. Jesus walked down the street one day and heard a woman screaming and some men laughing. He walked up and said, well, here he comes again. She says, you don't know what happened this time. What happened? Says, she's getting beat because she's a whore. Says, she's a prostitute. So we called her. And being prostitute, so that breaks the religious law. It breaks the political law. Says, she's wrong. Says, she's a whore. She's a prostitute. And so you should step back. He said, no, but before you throw another rock. He said, now, you say she's a prostitute? Yeah. You can't prostitute by yourself. Said, where's her partner? Prostitutes need partners. So by the way, if there are any among you throwing rocks who were with her, wish you could have tried to throw a rock. And then the rocks move. He then said to her, now you sin no more, you prostitute no more, and go in peace. What made him defend that woman on this character question? He knew she was not born a prostitute. What sent her down that road? Was it that she saw some adults having sex prematurely and injured her innocence? Was she in desperation trying to make some money because she was poor and so lost her head, which was her body? Maybe she had been lured by some older man and tricked. Whatever it was, she was not born there. She's still my child. She still matters. All of us matter. And so, we must be open for forgiveness, redemption, renewal, and move to higher ground. Middlesex, keep dreaming. Keep fighting. You are the answer. Keep hope alive. God bless you. I wish Santa would do at least a verse of If I Can Help Somebody. Please come forward, Santita.
If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can cheer traveling wrong, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall not be in vain. Oh, then my living shall not be in vain. If I can help somebody as I pass along in my living shall know.
Somebody. I am somebody. Respect me. Protect me. Never neglect me. I am somebody. Red and yellow, brown, black, and white. We're all precious in God's sight. Everybody is somebody. Everybody is somebody. Everybody is somebody. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive.